진짜.
제가 말했던 내용이 있으면 이제
No, it's good, thanks. Keep it as easy as possible.
Please give me advice as a struggling Muslim. How do we curb our ego? I mean, just simple advice on how to deal with this ego which always wants to be right.
Yeah, how to curb the ego? I wish I had the answer. So I married a Malaysian woman from Kerinci. You know, one time I came from this talk and she said, you changed, you're arrogant. That's why you need a good wife. You know, a good wife will put you in check. We don't like it as men because it bruises our ego. And I think she's from what, Ras Milan? What's this place called? Yeah. Ras Milan, your women there are tough anyways, right? So number one is to have a good spouse. You know, really, you need a spouse because a spouse is libas, is your garment. That's why marriage is important. You're not getting married to get a trophy wife, dude. You're not giving, you're marrying someone to have a six pack. I mean, that's great if they have it. Two will work, right? But you're marrying someone to help you control your ego and to draw nearer to Allah. And that's what your parents do for you. And we also do for our parents. It's a give and take. You know, my son one time, he said, you know, I don't want to go to the masjid for Fajr. I was tired. He's like, you're not going to go to Fajr? What kind of imam are you? I was like, you're 6 years old. Shut up, dude. He's like, how can you tell me to shut up? What kind of? I was like, okay, all right. Yeah. So number one, Sister Sue, I know her. She's a great sister. Is to have a good family unit around you. Number two is to have good brothers and sisters who don't only talk about Coach purses and going to the mall, and who's got the latest shoes. That's a fitna. There's times to talk about that. You know, there's times to talk about, you know, looking clean and dressing nice and, you know, shopping at the pavilion or whatever, wasting your money. There's a time for that. But that should not be the daily, you know, diet of a Muslim. The Prophet was asked, who are the best friends to have? In a good hadith, he said, those who, when you see them, remind you of Allah. And when they talk, they remind you of the hereafter. And when they act, they remind you that you're going to meet Allah. So friends, don't let friends' ego drive drunk. They advise their friends if they see them going astray. And they do so with love and courtesy, not hardship. The nafs always wants to put a do not disturb sign. Do not disturb, man. Leave me alone. Because the nafs want to take over. Number three is to have a good teacher. And I encourage you to start with Quran. Don't start with groups. Don't start with ideologies or certain, you know, isms in the community we talked about. Start with revelation. Imam Malik said, what will clean the later hearts of the ummah, what will clean the hearts of the later ummah is what cleaned the hearts of the earlier part of the ummah. That's why. To have a relationship with Quran. Listen to lectures like, you know, Nu'man Ali Khan, for example. His tafsir is off the chain, man. His tafsir is beautiful, right? Have someone around you that you can study with. And for many of you, and this is a reality in Malaysian society, many of you would rather study in English than Malay. And that's why there needs to really be imams. You know, I was in Azhar, I was teaching at the Malaysian dormitory, I was teaching them English. And I said, I want these all Kelantanese, you know, imams, mashallah. I said, I want to teach you some words in English so you're able to communicate with your own people. Number one, because you're Kelantanese dialect. I don't understand anything you're saying. No offense. And then secondly, most Malays now are comfortable studying in English. They don't read Jawi. How many of you can still write Joey? My daughter's like, I hate Joey, man. Like, don't hate it, love it. It's so hard. It's not hard. And this is a girl who can already write Arabic. So you should definitely learn how to write Joey. But finding someone who can teach you in a way that suits what's comfortable for you and helps you grow, inshallah. The last is increase your ibadah and increase individual secret ibadah. You know, Sheikh Sayyid Ahmed Rafa'i, great Sufi from the Shadhari Tariqah, rahimahullah. He said something, wallahi, it moved me when I read it. He said, I looked at turuq da'awiyah. I looked at all the efforts of like Islamic work. And I found those that were popular were full. You know, the cool stuff, you know, like introducing Maher Zain. Oh, that's really hard on the nafs. Yeah, God. I got to interview, you know, I got to hang out with Sheikh Suhaib all day. Oh, it's so hard on the soul. Wow. Oh, I got to be with Sammy Youssef, darn it. You know, that appeals to the soul. He said, but then I looked at the ways of making dhikr alone with Allah, being in dua alone, crying to Allah, salah, sujood, when no one sees you, doing acts of sadaqah, when no one sees you, contributing at a community. When Zainul Abidin died, you know how they knew he died? You know how they knew the kind of person he was, the grandson of Sayyidina Ali? Because when he died, the request for zakah increased. Because he was giving people sadaqah. So when he died, a community died with him. Because he was secretly taking care of the poor. He was doing something secretly. My teacher used to tell me, always do something that no one knows about except Allah. Always do something secret that is like a gift to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala between you and Him. So Sheikh Sayyid Ahmed Rafa'i, rahimahullah ash-Shadiri, he said, when I looked at those ways, the ways I'm talking about now, sacrifice, not receiving the acclaim of the people, doing acts of benevolence and altruism that are not advertised on 144 characters. I mean, people are tweeting, can you imagine? Man, I just had the greatest experience in Fajr. Why would you tweet that? I was moved to tears in Taraweeh. Why did you tweet that? You know, man, I just gave sadaqah. Why would you tweet that? There's a, you know, if there's a call for, you know, for example, to donate to the Burmese Muslims or to help people in Syria, yeah, we should be public with that because it's something that's needed. But something that's private between you and your Lord should stay private. I remember when I memorized Surah Al-Baqarah, my teacher told me, don't tell anyone. I wanted to tell everyone. He said, don't tell anyone. I said, why? He said, I want you to learn to hide good deeds. So Sheikh Sayyid Ahmed Rafa'i said, when I looked at those ways, فَإِذَا هِيَ فَارِغَ رَحِمُهُ. He said, there was no one there. Popular dawah, everyone is there. Being cool, the sisters like me because I got this dope kufi on. You know, all the brothers like my jilbab with the fluorescent, you know, threads. You know, oh, I want this, you know, Nordout foundation so bros can check me out. If you're like that, you need to fear Allah. And that's the absence of tarbiyah. There needs to be the usra, where you sit with people and you learn group work. The last way to do that is to work with people. It's easy to be a solo artist. It's easy to pull away. The Prophet ﷺ said that the lone sheep is the first one to be devoured by the wolf. So it's a sense, again, of empowerment and destructionism. I can't work with people, man. They don't understand me. I know what's best. That's wrong. But to work as a collective is actually an art. To work with different types of people, different levels of faith, different talents, different economic realities. If you're able to work at that level, you have mirrored the Sahaba. Because that's what the Sahaba were, a collective of diverse people. We'll take a few more questions. I don't have a problem, inshallah. So no problem, inshallah.